Hey everyone, my name is Prashant Kumar, or PK, and I'm an MCAT tutor at Shemmassian Academic Consulting. Today, we're going to be walking through a chem phys passage dealing with organic chemistry. You should be taking roughly 8.5 minutes on each of these passages, but today, we're going to be taking our time and going a little more in depth so you can see exactly what tips, tricks, and strategies I'm using as I tackle this section. Let's get it. Great, so I've gone ahead and put the passage on the left and the questions on the right. So feel free to take a moment to pause the video, go through it at your own pace, and come back to us. If not, let's go right into strategy. So usually I like to go paragraph by paragraph in each of these sections. The reason I like to do this is it provides a little bit of accountability, making sure I understand exactly what's going on in the paragraph before I go on to the next one. I like to write a 3 to 5 word summary between each of these paragraphs, and this is exactly what I said before, a check-in. I don't want to have to reread the entire passage when I can just reread a certain paragraph if I don't understand something. So that's what we're going to do. And then here we're going to also see some figures, and we see these in a lot of the science passages. I personally don't like to spend too much time on the figures on the first read, just because we don't know exactly what's going on and what questions they could ask. Why waste time when we are going to have to come back eventually? So let's get right into it. Palladium complexes and palladium catalysis reactions are important tools in the synthesis of other organic molecules. The importance of these reactions is highlighted by the citation for the Nobel Prize in Chemistry 2010, which was awarded for palladium catalyzed cross-couplings in organic synthesis. All right, so it's an easy question I ask myself. What is going on? And the answer is, all that we're looking at is palladium complex and reactions. It doesn't have to be complicated at all. In fact, we want to keep it as simple as possible. No one is going to read this other than us. And so I use abbreviations, arrows, anything. And so this is all I'm writing, palladium complexes and reactions. And if I want to be a little more specific, I'm just write synthesis. Oops. Synthesis. Great. And so let's go on to the next paragraph. Palladium catalysis continues to be studied to further the current understanding of the mechanism and seek new applications for its usage. Beta hydrogen elimination appears to play a key role in reactions of palladium catalysis. The eliminated hydrogen atom usually falls into one or two categories, depending on the molecular hybridization of the carbon atom it is attached to. Great. And so I don't like to focus too much on details. I want to get the big picture, the thesis of each of these paragraphs, right? And so here it's talking about a beta hydrogen elimination to palladium catalysis, right? Abbreviations, arrows, perfect. And there's so many details. It talks about these two categories, the molecular hybridization. We don't really care about that too much right now. Rather, we want to focus on the big picture because if they ask us for the details, we want to know where to come back to. All right, let's go on to the next paragraph. The most common carbon hybridization of a such atom is sp3. Both alkyl and alkanyl palladium complexes in this pathway undergo a mechanism to create olefins and alenes. Of lesser abundance in this context is sp2 hybridized carbon atoms. The products resulting from this scheme are poorly investigated. The two modes of elimination are shown in figure 1, and then they show us these two figures. And so here, again, not going to focus on the details. I'm going to talk about two reactions plus hybridizations, right? And so now we know that they're talking about sp3 and sp2 carbons and like olefins, alanes, but we know exactly where to come back if a question asks us for this. And then again, like I said earlier, we're not going to spend too much time on the figures themselves. We see that there's a reaction. If we look closer, we see there are two types of beta hydrogen elimination, but we're not even going to focus on that right now. We want to just focus on the big picture. And so let's just go on to the next paragraph then. Researchers seek to generate alenes from the second mode of palladium catalysis, involving sp2 hybridized carbon atoms. To do so, a pathway in which a desired alpha or delta allylic palladium intermediate is generated from oxidative addition isomerization of classic allylic alcohol derivatives of palladium. The proposed reaction is shown in figure 2. All right, And so this is the reaction it's talking about. And so again, I don't like to focus too much on the figures, but what is happening? And so this is the second reaction, right? That's what we're looking at. And this is talking about the delta allelic palladium intermediate, right? A little bit longer of a summary, but exactly. We're talking about the second reaction from the previous paragraph, and we're focusing on this delta allelic palladium intermediate from this reaction, right? And I'm not gonna go too much into depth here. No, usually we don't even have to come back to these sort of summaries. It's more of like a table of contents in a sense. You're gonna use it to find the details you're looking for. All right, and with that, we're ready to go on to our questions. All right, and so I have the first question right here. All right, which of the following types of reactions is investigated in the experiment? A, SN1 and E1, B, SN1 and SN2, C, E1 and E2, D, E1 and SN2. All right, so the first question is, are we looking at synthesis reactions or elimination reactions? Because oftentimes this dichotomy and understanding which one's which can help us eliminate a lot of answer choices. And so we should be realizing, and we wrote it up here, right? We're talking about elimination, right? We're talking about elimination reactions, not nucleophilic attack or anything like that. We're talking about beta hydrogen elimination. Whoops, let's go a little smaller. But yes, that is the big takeaway. And so right away we can eliminate any reaction, any choice, answer choice that has only SN1s and SN2s. And since we don't see anything talking about nucleophilic addition anywhere else, we can already eliminate SN1 and SN2 as answer choices, leaving us only with C, right? We're dealing with only only elimination reactions, no nucleophilic attack reactions. And so right away, very simple question, just from looking at that detail, right? We're only focused on beta hydrogen elimination. And so that realizes into the reaction we're looking at right now. Great. So already we're one for one, and we did that by a simple elimination tool, right? We saw no synthesis, no nucleophilic addition reactions, only elimination reactions. Great. So question two. According to the information presented in figure two, which of the following molecules has a good leaving group? All right. So right away, it says figure two, and so we can highlight that if we want. But figure two means we have to look at figure two. So it's one of these sort of compounds, and the answer choices are molecule 1, molecule 3A, molecule 4A, or molecule 5A. So I'll highlight them here, 1, 3A, 4A, or 5A. Great. So which of these has the best leaving group is the question. And so what is a leaving group? We should have an understanding of what a good leaving group is. And a good leaving group is generally highly electronegative, okay? And if we pull up our periodic table, we know the trend is going to be highly electronegative towards the top and the right. And so we should have a good understanding of these as good leaving groups. And right away, one leaving group stands out. And this is a common leaving group, right? It's a leaving group that can hold on to the electronegative charge if it's kicked off the molecule. And that is bromine, right? Bromine is a very, very commonly seen leaving group. And we don't, let's look at the other ones. Right away, we have isolated 3A as having a good leaving group, right? But let's take a look of the other ones. Okay, we have OAC, and OAC is nowhere near as good of a leaving group as bromine. Bromine can hold on to the negative charge much better. And so we can eliminate one. And then 4A, this is a really bulky molecule. This N2CO2ME can't really hold on to that negative charge well because it's a little bulkier and honestly a little more electrophilic. It'll want the attack as opposed to anything else. So we can eliminate molecule 4A. 5A, I don't see any sort of leaving group. There's nothing. It looks like a very stable molecule, so we can eliminate molecule 5A as well. And right away, we know, based on this, that molecule 3A is our best leaving group. And this, we honestly didn't even need to eliminate the other answer choices. When we think of good leaving groups, we should look for very, very strong electronegative elements. And in this case, bromine is a very, very common one. And so we know that that one stands out. Great. And so right away, we're 2 for 2. Keep it going. Oops. All right, let's go on to question number 3. All right, great. Question number 3. Which of the following is required for an E2 reaction? A, a good leaving group. B, an antihydrogen. C, a carbonyl that's good target for attack. Or D, a suitable leaving group and an antihydrogen. And so these types of questions are pretty common. You need to have the understanding of what an SN1, an SN2, an E1, and an E2 reaction are. And these are 4 staple reactions where you don't need to know as in depth that you might see on an orgo final, but you do need to know some familiarity with these types of reactions, okay? And so just so we have familiarity, let's draw out what an E2 reaction looks like, okay? So there's gonna be an H, so let's say a BR, and then let's just put a CH3 and a CH3, and then we'll have another CH3 and a CH3 here too, okay? Great. And so with an E2 reaction, right, what's the reaction mechanism, okay? We're going to have a base come off and attack this hydrogen. The hydrogen bond is going to kick down onto this bond, and then we're going to kick off the bromine, okay? And so this is the mechanism of an E2 reaction, okay? And so with this, there are 2 necessities that we need. Well, first off, we need the bromine, right? We need something to leave this reaction, so a good leaving group. But what else do we need? Well, we need this hydrogen, and not just any hydrogen. We need an antihydrogen, something that is opposite to the orientation of the leaving group. So in this case, the BR is pointed down, we need an H that's pointed up. If one was pointing into the page, then the other one would need to be pointing off the page, and vice versa. And so right away, there's only one answer choice that stands out, and that's D, right? A suitable leaving group and an antihydrogen. We can't just have a good leaving group or an antihydrogen, right? That's not really important. And a carbonyl that's good for target for attack has nothing to do with an E2 reaction, right? This E2 reaction is dealing with a hydrogen that jumps down and kicks off a leaving group by building a double bond. So right away, we are 3 for 3, and we're ready to go on to the last question. Question 4. Which of the following functional groups listed below are considered to be good electrophiles? A, aldehyde ketone carboxylic acid amines. B, aldehyde ketone carboxylic acid. C, aldehyde alcohols. D, hydroxyl carboxylic acid and ketone. All right, so we always want to focus on what the question's asking, and we're looking for electrophiles. This is very important. And so we should have an understanding of what electrophiles are, right? There's something that wanna be attacked, right? And can stabilize an attack. And so right away, we can eliminate hydroxyl acids, carboxylic acids, ketones, because a hydroxyl group is not really a great electrophile. What are great electrophiles are the carboxylic acid and ketone part of this. And so we have this part and this part that we like. And again, if we have a hydroxyl and an alcohol, we don't want that to be attacked, but we do want an aldehyde. An aldehyde is a great electrophile. And so right away, we're narrowed down to these A and B choices. We have an aldehyde, ketone, carboxylic acid, or an amine. And now we have to think about what an amine is. Is an amine a good electrophile? No, an amine is often seen attacking things. So it's a good nucleophile. So we can eliminate answer choice A, and we're left with B. We have an aldehyde, ketone, and carboxylic acid, and these are very common electrophiles. Most of the reactions you see with an electrophile are with these ones, right? Carboxylic acid, ketone, aldehyde, very, very common. And right away, we have eliminated the other answer choices to give us B. And this is a very easy standalone question if we know our electrophiles and nucleophiles. Well, great. Right away, we're 4 for 4. Amazing. Great work, y'all. We crushed a chem phys passage dealing with orgo, oftentimes students' least favorite subject on the MCAT. Hopefully this helped you get a little bit into my head and see how I tackle these passages, and you took away some tips or tricks to help you on this section. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel so you don't miss out on any prep for your MCAT. And feel free to subscribe to the link in our bio to MCAT Daily Question of the Day, created by one of our 528 scorers, or check out the playlist to see how you can score a 528 on the MCAT. Good luck and happy MCATing!